Welcome to Parsal classroom. Today we will be talking about the aortic valve surgery. So the stages of valvular disease, it has been classified into four groups, four stages. That is stage A, where the patient is at risk for the disease. Stage B, there is progressive disease, but the patient remains asymptomatic. In stage C, it is also subdivided into C1 and C2. In C1, there is severe asymptomatic disease, but there is compensated LV function. In C2, there is severe asymptomatic disease, but the decompensation of the LV function has been started. In stage D, there is severe disease and the patient is very much symptomatic. In this lecture, we'll be discussing the aortic stenosis and aortic regurgitation presentation and management. So we know that in our subcontinent, particularly in the India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, etc., and also the Southeast Asian countries, the rheumatic fever is the most common cause of valvular disease. So if we look at the incidence of the rheumatic fever, in developed countries it's only 0.3 per 1,000 population, whereas in North Africa it is 1.8, in Sub-Saharan Africa it is 5.7, in India it is 20 per 1,000 population, in Southeast Asia region it is altogether 28 per 1,000 population. So rheumatic fever is still a very common cause of valvular heart disease. If we categorize the causes of aortic stenosis requiring surgery, in that case we see that in below the age of 70 years, the bicuspid valve, aortic valve, predominates and it comprises about 50% of the cases. In post-inflammatory, it is 25% of the cases, and degenerative case comprise 18%. Unicommissural, it's a congenital anomaly of the aortic valve, it comprises only 3% of the cases. But if we consider more than 70 years of age, the degenerative cause, 48%, it predominates, and the bicuspid aortic valve is 27%, and post-inflammatory, it is 23%. Regarding the etiology, relatively younger age group, that is between 30 to 40 years of age, the rheumatic fever predominates and rheumatic valvular disease predominates. In 50 to 60 years age group, which is the bicuspid aortic valve, and in 70 to 90 years, it is the degenerative, that is the sclerotic disease, which predominates. The cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis is chest pain, syncope, and congestive heart failure. And if we do a physical examination, we can hear the heart squeaking systolic murmur, which is crescendo and decrescendo type, and it can be very much audible on the upper right sternal border or lower left sternal border, and sometimes to the apex in 15% of the cases. It has radiation to the carotid, and the aortic second heart sound is muffled. There will be anacrotic pulse, and the apical heave will be there, and the main physiology of aortic stenosis is due to pressure overload. So we categorize the aortic stenosis severity. We see that the aortic stenosis, if we measure the maximal Doppler velocity, the peak gradient is 4V², that is the, here V is the maximum velocity across the AV valve. And this gives rise to peak instantaneous gradient, and this gradient is a measurement of integration of the velocity over time. And if we multiply the peak gradient with 0.7, it gives the mean gradient, and it correlates, this Doppler measurement of mean gradient correlates very well with the catheter-based peak-to-peak pressure gradient. And the valve area is calculated by continuity equation. We know that A1, that is area 1, into velocity 1, V1, is equal to A2, that is area 2, into velocity 2. So if we can measure the larger area, that is the proximal area, and the velocity across the valve, proximal velocity and the distal velocity, the smallest area, that is the narrowest area, can be measured from this continuity equation. And accordingly, the aortic stenosis has been categorized into mild stenosis, moderate and severe stenosis, and a special category, that is the critical stenosis. In mild stenosis, the peak velocity ranges from 2 to 2.9 meter per second. In moderate stenosis, it is 3 to 3.9 meter per second. And in severe stenosis, it is more than 4 meter per second. And in critical stenosis, is more than 5 meter per second. And the gradient across the AV valve, in case of mild stenosis, it is less than 20 millimeter of mercury. In the moderate stenosis, it is 20 to 39 millimeter of mercury. And in severe stenosis, it is more than or equal to 40 millimeter of mercury. And if we measure the valve area, then in case of mild stenosis, it's more than 1.5 square centimeter. In moderate stenosis, it is 1.0 to 1.5 square centimeter. In severe stenosis, it is less than 1.0 square centimeter. And in critical stenosis, it is less than 0.7 square centimeter. In case of aortic regurgitation, this may be the primary valve disease where the valve leaflet is always affected, and it is the rheumatic fever is the predominant cause. But apart from that, there may be congenital, that is bicuspid aortic valve or outlet supracrestal VSD, or which may lead to the aortic valve leaflet collapse and leading to aortic regurgitation. And there may be discrete subaortic stenosis which impairs the leaflet function. And sometimes there is endocarditis, damage to the leaflet, and other inflammatory disorder, degenerative and traumatic leaflet rupture. All this may lead to aortic regurgitation. In secondary aortic regurgitation, here the leaflet is not the main culprit, but the aortic root dilatation and the wall of the aorta and the supporting connective tissue, which are in jeopardy. And this aortic root dilatation, or whenever there is aortic dissection, damage to the aortic annulus occurs, and the collapsing of the intimal flap with intact leaflets and annulus, and the leaflet collapses and causing aortic regurgitation. And the symptoms in majority of the cases is dyspnea, or sometimes there may be overwhelming feature of congestive heart failure. And on examination, we can find out the murmur is diastolic and it is high-pitched, blowing decrescendo murmur. It ends before the mid-diastole and can be very much audible in the left mid sternal border or left lower sternal border, that is left second to fourth intercostal space, or to the apex. Heart based leaning forward at the end of expiration with pump pressure. And there are other findings like widened pulse pressure with abnormal pulses, that is the Corrigan or water hammer type of pulse. Dancing carotids may be there. There may be Quinquel signs like landward pulsation, Derosis murmur, or two or four pistol shoot murmur of top. These all can be present, or someone may be present but others may be absent. And the apex beat is displaced, and the volume overload is the underlying pathophysiology. And aortic regurgitation has been again categorized into mild, moderate, and severe, depending upon some qualitative and quantitative assessment. In qualitative assessment, there is angiographic grading like 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 to 4 plus, and color Doppler jet, if it affects the central jet and weight less than the 25% of the LVOT, it is called mild type of aortic regurgitation. If the regurgitant jet is greater than the mild but no signs of severe aortic regurgitation, that is more than 25 but less than 65% of the LVOT, if the jet is present, occupy those areas, then it is moderate. And in severe type, there is central jet with wide greater than 65% of the LVOT. And in case of mild disease, the Doppler vena contracta wide is less than 0.3. And if it is between 0.3 to 0.6, it is moderate. And in severe cases, it's more than 6. there are a lot of peripheral signs of severe chronic aortic regurgitation, and like Austin Flint marker, it's a mid-diastolic marker, heart based at the apex. There may be Baker signs, Bisperians or Waterhammer pulse, Corrigan signs, Demoussard signs, Jeruzzi signs, that is the systolic murmur heard over the femoral artery when it is compressed proximally, and a diastolic murmur when it is compressed distally with a stethoscope. So it's similar to TROP sign, but it is audible through the stethoscope. There are Gerhardt sign, Hill sign, Main sign, Muller sign, Quinkin signs, that is the capillary pulsation in the nail bed, Rosenbach signs and TROP signs, that is the booming pistol shot systolic and diastolic sound heard over the femoral artery. There are some quantitative assessment of the degree of aortic regurgitation, and it is mild, moderate, and severe. The regurgitant volume ml per beat, if it is less than 30, then it is mild. Between 30 to 59 ml per beat, it is moderate, and greater than 60 or equal to 60, it is severe type of aortic regurgitation. Regurgitant fraction, if it is less than 30%, then it is mild. 30 to 49%, it is moderate, and greater than or equal to 50%, it is severe type of aortic regurgitation. Similarly, the regurgitant orifice area can be measured. If it is less than 0.10 square centimeter, then it is mild. 0.10 to 0.29 square centimeter, it is moderate. And when it is greater than 0.30 square centimeter, it is severe. And the left ventricular size, if it is increased, then it is a severe type of aortic regurgitation. So on the management, we know that the aortic valve surgery has a long history. It started in 1955 with mechanical aortic valve dilatation by Ellis and Kirklin. In 1956, aortic homograft valve replacement was done by Murray. In 1960, ball and prosthetic aortic valve was placed by Starr and Harkin. In 1967, pulmonary autograft in aortic position, that is the ROS1 procedure, was done. So what are the indications for aortic valve replacement in case of aortic stenosis? So we know that there are classes of recommendation, and there are level of evidences. Depending upon this, these classes of recommendation may be class 1, 2A, 2B. 3 is not an indication, but rather a contraindication. So we'll talk about the class 1 indication, 2A indication, and 2B indication. And the level of evidence varies between A, B, C, and the in case of A, it is the meta-analysis or multiple randomized control trial or a very large size randomized control trial from which evidences are gathered. In case of level of evidence B, in that case, a single RCT or multiple non-RCT, this can give rise to level of evidence B category. And in level C, it is the limited data or some case series or some non-randomized small sample size data that give rise to the evidences. So in case of class 1 recommendation, when there is symptomatic stage D disease, there is no controversy about that, aortic valve replacement should be done. In case of asymptomatic cases, if the LV ejection fraction is less than 50%, in that case, or when it is done with other cardiac surgery, there is no doubt that aortic valve replacement should be done, and it is a class 1 indication, class 1 recommendation. But when the patient is asymptomatic and the it falls into the moderate category, in that case, the aortic valve replacement should be done, and it is a 2A type of indication. Whenever there is low surgical risk, even when the Vmax, that is the velocity across the valve, is less than more than 0.3 meter per second increment, in that case aortic valve replacement should be done. But whenever there is Vmax, that is the velocity across the valve of moderate category, between 3 meter per second to 3.9 meter per second, and the gradient across the valve is between 20 to 39 millimeter of mercury, there are two approaches, either symptomatic or asymptomatic. When there is symptomatic, but there is deterioration of the LV function, particularly with decrease of LV ejection fraction, then aortic valve replacement should be done, and it is a 2A category of recommendation. And whenever even the patient is asymptomatic, in that case, when other cardiac surgery is done, in that case also aortic valve replacement should be done, and it's a 2A category of indication. And now, what is the point to choose between the transcatheter aortic valve replacement and surgical AVR, SAVR, TAVR versus SAVR. In that case, in case of severe symptomatic stage disease, when there is low surgical risk, surgical AVR is preferable. When there is intermediate surgical risk, surgical AVR is preferable, or a TAVR, depending upon other factors. That is, the transcatheter aortic valve replacement is done, but the class one indication is the surgical AVR. In high surgical risk, surgical and or TAVR, SAVR or TAVR, both can be done. Both are of class one recommendation. But when there is prohibitive surgical risk, when surgery cannot be done, in that case, we have no other alternative than to do a transcatheter aortic valve replacement, and it is a class one indication. Indication for aortic valve replacement in aortic regurgitation: in case of severe AR, symptomatic stage disease, there is no doubt AVR should be done. When there is asymptomatic presentation, but LV ejection fraction is decreasing, in that case AVR should be done. And when it is combined with other cardiac surgery, AVR should be done. When the LV ejection fraction is preserved, in that case, when there is increase in LV end systole diameter more than 50 millimeter, in that case AVR should be done, and it is a 2A type of recommendation. When the LV end diastolic volume is more than 65 millimeter, in that case AVR should also be done, and it is a 2B type of recommendation. When there is progressive AVR, when with other cardiac surgery, then AVR should be done. When without other cardiac surgery, that is, no other cardiac surgery is necessary, in that case, periodic monitoring should be done. And whenever there is LV dysfunction, like a reduction in the ejection fraction or increase in the end diastolic volume more than 65 millimeter of millimeter, or end systolic volume more than 50 millimeter, in that case, AVR should be done. Now, what are the type of replacement aortic valve? It may be tissue valve or mechanical valve. The tissue valve may be autograft, where the patient's own pulmonary valve is dissected out and used to replace the aortic valve, like Ross 1 procedure, or in case of mitral valve, it is Ross 2 procedure. Homograft, when valves are harvested from the donor hearts and preserved, this can be used. Xenograft, which are made of porcine or bovine valvular or pericardial tissue, this is a xenograft. Autografts and homografts take the form of aortic valve in situ with intact aortic root, complete with coronary ostia and a fringe of myocardium. This fringe of myocardium is sometimes dangerous because they imbibe calcium and ultimately leads to early degeneration. So this myocardial tissue is trimmed as far as it is practicable. Xenografts, which resemble the aortic leaflets in isolation, are usually mounted on a small metal support or stent, but a new generation of stentless bioprosthesis are also available. mechanical valve. It is composed of pyrolyte carbon and occasionally metal alloys covered with pyrolyte carbon are classified according to their structure into cased ball valve, tilting disc valve, and this tilting disc valve may be a single tilting disc valve or bilifted valve. Search for a perfect valve. Can we get a perfect valve? The perfect replacement valve would have a structural lifetime longer than the patient, an intrinsic gradient of 0 millimeter of mercury, a hemodynamic profile of the original valve, carry no infective and thrombotic risk, be cheap, readily available, and technically easy to insert and silent. Practically, none of the valve fulfills all this criteria. These are the different types of valve you see from the left to right. This is the bilifted valve, the single tilting disc valve, the ball case valve, the tissue valve, and the valve with the ascending aorta, aortic root, and the newer generation of valve, the core valve, etc. Mechanical valves are durable and lasting, with exception of a few rare technical failures. For 20 to 30 years, they may remain functional. Their main drawbacks include the high transvalvular pressure gradient in the smaller sizes, an abnormal hemodynamic profile, thrombogenicity, high infection rate, and hemolysis. A significant minority of patients finds that the noise of the functioning mechanical valve that is produced is their greatest drawback. Sometimes the patient remains intolerant to this type of noise produced by this mechanical valve. The intrinsic transvalvular gradient for a mechanical valve is higher than that of a equivalently sized bioprosthesis. The effect on the left ventricle of changing the mobile three-dimensional structure of the aortic annulus, you know the aortic annulus is crown-shaped, and we convert it when we place a mechanical valve, we convert it into two-dimensional structure, that is a two-dimensional plane, and this may have a deleterious effect, but we are not sure about the effect, long-term effect. So depending upon the stage of the disease, the valvular management of the disease also differ. In stage A, at risk for the disease, we should observe the patient with a serial echocardiography at 3 to 5 years interval. In stage B or progressive disease, we will observe the patient with echo at 1 to 3 years interval. In stage C1 disease, where there is severe disease, but the patient is asymptomatic and the LV function is compensated, there is controversy whether we should follow up this patient with regular interval of echocardiography at 6 to 12 month interval, or we should go for an intervention. But there is no doubt that in severe C2 stage, severe asymptomatic patient with decompensated LV function, it should be intervened by whatever method we need. In stage D, that is severe disease symptomatic patient, here the intervention is also mandatory. In 2017 and in 2019 focused guideline updates, there has been some changes from the previous guidelines. In case of prosthetic valve of choice, so a shared decision making should be done by the surgeon as well as the patient, and it remains a class 1 indication with level of evidence C type with limited data in selecting a mechanical versus a bioprosthetic valve. Among patients undergoing aortic or mitral valve replacement, the age range was expanded from 60 to 70 to age 50 to 70 for the class 2A, that is level of evidence B, non-randomized trial, indication for either a mechanical or bioprosthetic valve of choice. So now, from now on, we can choose bioprosthetic valve even from 50 years of age. Depending upon the clinical scenario, we'll have to take the decision, and this decision should be made by the surgeon as well as the patient himself. Prosthetic valve anti-thrombotic therapy. This has also been changed to some extent. There were unchanged recommendation for vitamin K antagonist. So the vitamin K antagonist is still, that is the warfarin, is still the drug of choice as anticoagulant, but the NOAC, that is novel oral anticoagulant, or that directly oral anticoagulants are still not in use for management of this prostatic valve. And the international normalized ratio, that is INR, is fixed at 2.5 for bileaflet or current generation tilting disc valve in the absence of additional thromboembolic risk. When there is additional thromboembolic risk, INR 30 for mitral mechanical prosthesis and for aortic valve prosthesis. Plus, when there is additional thromboembolic risk, aspirin should be added with a dose of 75 to 100 milligram among patients with mechanical valve prosthesis. There is now a new consideration for lower INR target rate of 1.5 to 2.0 for patients with 1x bileaflet mechanical aortic valve and no additional thromboembolic risk. It is a class 2B recommendation, and the level of evidence is B, randomized control trial, depending upon the randomized control trial. The prior recommendation for the use of vitamin K antagonist after bioprosthetic valve replacement was changed to include both the aortic and mitral valve prosthesis for 3 to 6 months. Previously, it was 3 months after surgery, but now it is 3 to 6 months after surgery in patients with low risk for bleeding. When a vitamin K antagonist, that is INR target 2.5, may be reasonable for at least 3 months after TAVR in patients with low risk for bleeding. So there are differences between the structural and non-structural valve deterioration between the mechanical as well as the bioprosthetic valve. In mechanical valve, thrombosis occurs in this leaflet and it in process upon this area. In case of bioprosthesis, it starts from the sewing ring to the leaflet and in process upon one leaflet and then another and another. In endocarditis, the mechanical valve starts circumferentially from the sewing ring to the valve ring. And in bioprosthesis, it starts on one or other leaflets. Penis formation also starts from the periphery to the center in both these. And structural valve deterioration, wear and tear occurs in the, it may be some perforation in the bioprosthetic leaflet, or it may be calcification and degeneration in the bioprosthetic leaflet. So we see that there is no controversy about the European Society of Cardiologists guideline and the American Heart Association or American Cardiological Society. There is SEC. There is no difference between the mechanical valve between 50 to 60 years of age. There is no difference between these two. But in case of bioprosthetic valve, the European Society of Cardiologists recommend that it can be used from 65 years of age onwards. But in ACC guideline, it is from the 70 years of age, the bioprosthetic valve is advocated. And this is the controversial area where, depending upon the individual patient, the decision should be made, and both valves can be used, either mechanical or bioprosthetic, depending upon the individual situation. So there is a lot of development of the bioprosthetic valve from earlier days to this days, and there are a lot of improvement in the technology, and this includes the fixation of the tissue, that is the tissue valve fixation. Originally there was high pressure fixation was used, later on it moved to low pressure fixation, now it has become zero pressure fixation. And to prevent early calcification, the new generation of valve has been developed, and it includes the tissue engineered valve, that is the composite valve, and the removal of the muscle bar. Zero pressure fixation is used, and it maintains the integrity of the valve very well, but do not give rise to any structural deterioration. And lot of anti-calcific remedies has been used. Particularly the latest one is the link technique. It has been used to prevent the calcification, early calcification of the valve. Toluidone glue similarly has been used to prevent calcification, and recent valve also includes the amino valve, amino acid valve, that is the saurine valve. So different techniques are used to improvise the valve, bioprosthetic valve. So bioprosthetic valve, if we classify it, it will be stented bioprosthetic valve and stentless bioprosthetic valve, homograft and autograft. In stented bioprosthetic valve, leaflets are made from two types of tissues. One is bovine pericardium, another is porcine aortic valve leaflet, and it is treated with chemical preservative. And it is mounted on flexible plastic or titanium metal frame stent covered with synthetic fabric, that is the sewing cap, and three stent posts are there, the studs, which further support the cuffs. Stentless bioprosthetic valve is also available. These are the chemically treated whole porcine aortic valve or a portion of the aortic root reinforced with pliable exterior cuff. So in that case, it is more technically demanding, but can be used in even a smaller aortic root. So similarly, the human homograft can also be used as a aortic valve or aortic valve conduit, and autograft as Ross procedure from the pulmonary autograft, it can be used to replace the aortic valve. This is the Ross procedure. Here the pulmonary valve is excised and it is placed in the aortic valve area with re-implantation of the coronary arteries, and the pulmonary valve is replaced by either a homograft or a xenograft. It can be used. There are modification of the techniques from open standard Modian sternotomy. The tendency, the trend has been switched over to minimally invasive valve replacement. And there are several ways of doing it. There is percutaneous peripheral cannulation, TAVI or transcatheter aortic valve implantation or replacement, heart port techniques, mini sternotomy, mini anterior thoracotomy, and surgery under epidural anesthesia, that is the aortic type of surgery, avoiding the effect of the general surgery can be used. So what are the difference? What are the advantages and disadvantages of minimally invasive versus conventional valve replacement? Overall, majority of the reported results are similar. That is the date, length of stay, and complication rate are more or less similar. Minor negative aspects of the minimally invasive procedure are longer cross-clamp time and longer bypass time. But increased early postoperative pain may be there. Some reports of improved outcome come with keyhole approach. But there are some advantages. So there is a lower risk of redo operation. Aortic vascular procedures can be done. Lower transfusion requirement are necessary. Lower incidence of postoperative atrial fibrillation. Lower postoperative pain, especially after day two. What will you do if the aortic root is very small, AVR in small aortic root? We can place the valve in supraannular position. We can tilt up the valve at the non-coronary sinus level, or we can enlarge the aortic root by either posterior root enlargement procedure or anterior root enlargement procedure. In posterior root enlargement procedure, the commonly used is Nick's procedure. By extending the aortotomy posteriorly through the non-coronary sinus across the aortic ring and inserting a patch to augment the annulus. Here, through this non-coronary sinus, we can cut up the aortic ring and the non-coronary sinus and enlarge it with the PAS, and then we can place the valve. And in case of Menagoan procedure, extending the incision through the commissar between the left and non-coronary. This is the left coronary sinus and this is the non-coronary sinus. Through this commissar, we can cut it across the aortic annulus, and even we may extend it to the anterior mitral leaflet, and then we can place a PAS to enlarge the aortic annulus, and we can accommodate a relatively larger size of valve. In anterior root enlargement, that is the Conner-Ruston procedure, here through the right ventricular outflow tract obstruction, we cut across the right ventricular outflow tract into the aorta, and we cut across the interventricular septum. Then we place a PAS over this interventricular septal defect, and we place the aortic valve, then cut this excess portion. Then we cover this aortotomy and the ventriculotomy by a single PAS. So there are two PASs necessary. One is inner PAS, another is outer PAS to do this Conner-Ruston procedure. How do we place the supraannular valve? If we place the valve internally, so the C-ring is here and between the annulus, we see a smaller size of valve. The effective orifice area in this case is smaller. But if we put it supraannularly, that is the sewing ring will be placed upon the annulus. In that case, from this area to this area, with a greater effective orifice area, we can place a valve. We can place a valve. So in case of supraannular placement, we'll have to plate the placet on the ventricular aspect of the annulus, and through the placet, then through the annulus, then through the sewing ring, we'll have to pass the sutures and tie it. So we can accommodate a relatively larger size valve if we place it supraannularly. So this is the supraannular placement of the valve. We see that the sewing ring is above the annulus. There are certain other types of valves. So in sutureless Percival S aortic valve, this is sutureless valve. Unlike traditional heart valve replacement, the Percival S is a self-anchoring. There are anchors, which means that it does not need to be sutured into the place because no sutures are required. Using Percival S results in reduced procedure time. So it is a very rapid procedure. We can do it very rapidly for aortic valve replacement. We need only 3 sutures to place the valve in its proper position. Then we can remove the suture, and ultimately the valve can be anchored. This is the TAVI valve, per catheter, transcatheter aortic valve implantation. And this valve can be of two types. One is self-expandable valve, another is balloon dilatable valve. So TAVI can be done in the very high-risk patient who have prohibitive risk for open surgery. And we see that this TAVI approaches can also be done through either transcatheter, that is the femoral route, through the aorta itself it can be done, or from the transapical route, that is the LV apex, it can be also be placed. The aortic valve can also be addressed through this transapical approach. Aortic valve repair. Aortic valve repair is nearly exclusively limited to the patient with aortic regurgitation without a component of aortic stenosis. Whereas in TAVI, we do it in case of aortic stenosis. TAVI is not possible in case of aortic regurgitation because the annular size is very large, and in that case, we cannot get a very large size valve to accommodate to be placed in the large size annulus. So in case of aortic stenosis, TAVI can be done, but in case of aortic regurgitation, we can do aortic valve repair also. So a majority of the aortic valve repair is done with the aortic regurgitation. Patient considered for repair are generally young who wish to avoid anticoagulation and would be expected to outlive a tissue valve should replacement be considered. In order to perform this operation, the cusp must be thin and flexible without classic calcification. Most repair results in downsizing the effective orifice area in order to increase the cooptation with available cusp area. There is a resultant increase in the aortic valve gradient, and this must be anticipated when evaluating patient preoperatively. The decision to repair an aortic valve is made by weighing the risk of repair failure versus the benefit of avoidance of oral anticoagulation therapy. So before going into repair, we must have a clear-cut idea about the anatomy of the aortic valve, whether it is tricuspid type of aortic valve or it is bicuspid type of aortic valve without raphe or with one raphe, or unicuspid aortic valve with two raphes. So it should be categorized accordingly into, depending upon the echocardiographic finding, we should categorize it, and we should have a clear conception about the repair technique. And there are different measurements for effective repair. We need this type of measurement. For example, CH, that is the cooptation height. Cooptation height is this area where the valve leaflet will overlap each other. So this is the cooptation height. If we do not have adequate cooptation height, in that case, the valve will be regurgitant again. Another is the effective height, starting from the annulus to the height of the commissure. So that is the effective height. Another is the commissural height. That is, commissural height is this height, commissural height. And there are so different types of measurement, cooptation area. So this type of commissural height is starting from the annulus to this height of the commissure. So this is the commissural height. So this is cooptation height, this is commissural height, and this is the effective height. So we'll have to measure this height preoperatively, and accordingly we'll have to correct it. And a transesophageal echocardiography is a must in the operation theater. And so we'll have to measure this type of finding after doing this aortic valve repair. So again, we'll have to categorize whether it is the normal aorta, whether there is aortic root dilatation, or whether there is ascending aortic dilatation. So in normal aorta, the regurgitant jet, there is normal cusp movement related to the aortic root or ascending aorta dilatation with a central jet. Only the central jet is here in case of normal aorta. In case of aortic root dilatation, the aortic incompetence occurs due to cusp prolapse. This cusp has prolapsed downwards, and with eccentric jet, the jet is eccentric jet. In type 3, when there is ascending aortic dilatation, there is cusp retraction. So there is the cusp is separated from each other. So there is a large gap. And with poor tissue quality and quantity, with large central and eccentric jet. So there is large central and eccentric jet. So planning of this type of repair depends upon the categorization of the aortic valve itself, as well as the aortic root and the ascending aorta. Depending upon the phenotypic presentation, we'll have to calculate, we'll have to plan different types of repair technique. We'll have to adopt it. So if there is normal root and ascending aorta, if the aortic annulus is less than 25 millimeter, no annuloplasty for subcommissural aorta is necessary. So only the valve repair technique, that is this commissural pleated annuloplasty is enough. If it is more than 25 millimeter or equal to 25 millimeter of mercury, along with that, we will have to place double sub and supra annular annuloplasty ring. We'll have to reinforce it with the annuloplasty ring if it is more than 25 millimeter. Similarly, in case of dilated root, if it is less than 25 millimeter, in that case, remodeling alone, that is, we'll have to use a conduit with some scalloping elliptical process in between this stent, that is the commissural post, and we'll have to re-implant the coronary arteries on that. But if it is more than 25 millimeter, in that case, we can use a modified type of conduit which has a sinus, artificial sinus along with it, and an ascending aortic portion of the conduit. In that case, we'll have to re-implant the coronary arteries again, but it can also be modified by this type of technique along with an annuloplasty ring to strengthen the subcommissural aortic tissue. This tissue is actually ventricular tissue which has impinged, which has encrossed into the aortic tissue. So we'll have to strengthen it. In case of dilated ascending aorta, if it is less than 25 millimeter, we can replace the ascending aorta itself. And we can, if it is more than 25 millimeter of mercury, in that case, along with ascending aorta replacement, we'll have to do place a subcommissural annuloplasty ring. So this valve repair should be done in such a way that the coaptation height remains intact. And in this way, we can do this type of subcommissural aortoplasty, different types of subcommissural aortoplasty, or we can do some aortoplasty straight away with this type of ascending aorta replacement with this scalloping technique. So sometimes pleated commissuroplasty, when there is much more aortic regurgitation, to make it more competent, we need this type of pleated commissuroplasty to make it more competent. And sometimes one valve area may be redundant, in that case, a triangular excision, and then pleated commissuroplasty will be necessary. Similarly, when there is a defect in the leaflet tissue, we can repair it with a pass of pericardium and to make it competent. So this is all about aortic valve replacement and management of the aortic stenosis and aortic regurgitation in short. I think this video will be helpful. You will have to go through the textbook if you want to know in detail about this type of technique, particularly the description of the surgical technique, but it will give you a brief idea, an overview idea about the aortic valve diseases and its management. Thank you very much.